Hello everyone. Thank you all very much. Am I echoing?
No.
No, okay. For coming. We're very grateful to have you here. Let me begin by expressing great intellectual, professional, and personal thanks to our guests, visitors, who in some cases have come quite a distance to take part in this colloquium that the journal Boundary 2 is sponsoring here at the University of Pittsburgh over the next day and a half. You will hear me say many more things about our guests as we go forward. I should also tell you a little bit about the calendar of events. We're going to begin with a brief panel with two shorter presentations. That will open an afternoon of events that will culminate in the later keynote by Phil Mirowski, who is our guest of honor, around whose work we are building this conference. But I also hope and strongly urge you to be sure to attend the other events which we have for the afternoon. We will begin now with a session with two speakers, Bruce Robbins and Chris Conley. And we'll then have a long plenary discussion from Frank Pasquale, culminating in Phil Mirowski's keynote later on today. And tomorrow, starting early in the morning in this room, we will continue with a mixture of panel discussions and lectures. I have to also thank the Boundary 2 Editorial Collective, some of whose members are here, some of whose members were planning to be here but could not be for reasons of health or complexity of personal life. I want to thank the members of the collective for honoring my request that we take the problem of neoliberalism and Mirowski's relationship to that problem as the occasion and center of this meeting. As you may or may not know, at each of our editorial board meetings, which now occur only twice a year, as opposed to the good old days when they occurred three times a year, at each of these meetings, we tend to sponsor a conference on either an assigned topic or a kind of open discussion of relevant work in the fields that we publish in. How did we come to this topic? Well, in a strange way, it's a result of a series of exchanges that I had during the 2013-2014 academic year, when another member of our editorial collective and a good friend for a long time, Vlad Godzish, who teaches in California, was a senior resident fellow at the Humanities Institute, the Humanities Center on this campus. Godzish and I were together much of the time during his visit, and we were debating the best way to try to understand the developments in the recent past which had led to whatever it is we could see beginning to come at us with lots of threat over the near horizon. So we wanted to know about the recent past, the vectors of development that led us or were leading us in a direction that we found intolerable, unfortunate, and perhaps underthought, underconsidered. So in those conversations, we, that is Godzich and I, found ourselves frequently, and if not repeatedly, returning to Mirowski's various writings on neoliberalism and the neoliberal thought collective. And we noticed and appreciated very much the difference between the general speculation about something called neoliberalism and the detailed historical research into a cluster of both ideas and institutions, that is to say, thought and practice, that featured centrally in Mirowski's work, and that leads to the important differentiation between neoliberalism as topic brand concept, however one wants to call that, and the neoliberal thought collective, something that allowed us to specify not only a set of ideas, but their placement within particular individuals, their development as the result of the actions and motives of human intent and desire, and to be able to begin the process of tracing the effects of those desires through the tactics and institutions which came within control or high influence of those that are called, or constitute the neoliberal thought collective and its developments, its consequences. So I approached the editorial collective and asked if they would be willing to accept this as a topic for our conversation, saying, among other things, because we needed to investigate not only the genealogies of the present moment, and we'll be careful how we use that word, not only to investigate the genealogies of the present moment, present formations, but also because we wanted to raise the speculative question about what it was that was happening to the human as a result of the transformations in what I'll call loosely the political economy. This is a topic of concern in recent years in the journal. It's the question of the human, as Tony Bogues, one of our other editorial members, repeatedly calls it. We discussed it at a meeting at Brown. But not only Bogues alone, but several other members of the collective have been thinking about what it means to discuss the human, what can the reference be, what is the history of the notion of the human, what is the human as itself historical. And we were thinking, along with, say, the figures that had something to do with Foucault and others, of something like a rupture, something like a transformational process, something like a willful intent on the part of the forces that motivate what we'll call the neoliberal thought collective to produce or to alter the nature of the human, resulting in a kind of creature that is somewhat different than the kind of creature that might have been imagined, say, by John Stuart Mill in his essay on liberty, and so on and so forth. So thinking around all of these kinds of questions, we gradually realized, in particular because of the political campaign, that there was a lot of immediate pressure on us to think more about this. And the editorial collective, some members individually and the group collectively, have turned to different aspects of the problems that have arisen as a result into full sight as a result of the campaign. So we're engaged in a series of projects looking into forms of authoritarianism online, offline, in real politics in the US, in transatlantic and transregional development, involving new technologies, the law, and so on and so forth. So we've gathered here today to try to have the kind of interdisciplinary conversation that gets out of the deep wells of subspeciality that many of us are obliged to live in as part of our professional lives. So we're going to start today to think along those lines with two speakers, first of whom will be Bruce Robbins. And I'm going to introduce everyone, although in the case of Bruce Robbins, since he's been here thankfully often, many of you know who he is, but nonetheless, let me say, for those of you who don't. Bruce Robbins is now the Old Dominion Foundation Professor in Humanities in the Department of English and Comparative Literature at Columbia University. He is a longtime member and active participant in the B2 Collective, and a world-renowned literary critic and public intellectual. In recent years, Bruce has turned his skills towards filmmaking. He has shown and spoken about his 2013 documentary, Some of My Best Friends Are Zionists, here on this campus. I think it's appropriate to add here that the film is available from Amazon as a DVD. He smiles.
It's available for free.
Oh, sorry, I didn't know that. Currently, he's completing a second documentary on the Israeli historian Shlomo Sand, and working on at least one book, which I know of, that is about literary representations of atrocity. He's especially well known for his original research into the histories and theories of cosmopolitanism and his analysis of the welfare state. Uniquely, he has combined concerns with these large contemporary historical political issues with detailed studies of literature and criticism, including especially studies of the novel. Among his many books in this context are the following titles: Upward Mobility and the Common Good, Toward a Literary History of the Welfare State, from Princeton in 2007. and 2011 from Duke, Immanuel Wallerstein and the Problem of the World System, Scale, Culture. His talk today is entitled Liberal Elites, and in this talk he will discuss with us rightist hostility to credentialed elites as a way to think about the state, about neoliberalism and the fate of the humanities. So please join me in welcoming Bruce Robbins.
This documentary is available at bestfriendsfilm.com. All right, for no money. Bestfriendsfilm.com. Okay, no preamble. Thank you, Paul, for the very generous introduction. One of the many contributions to our understanding of where we are now by our keynote speaker, Philip Mirowski, is his demonstration of how the discipline of economics seized disproportionate and undeserved disciplinary authority by leaning on culturally compelling metaphors. In a first stage, metaphors drawn from physics, then in a second stage, metaphors drawn from the computer. It's thanks to these metaphors we live by, so to speak, that the market became a kind of deity, a place where the buck of interpretation stops, and the necessity for competitiveness on the market became a figure for necessity itself. Neoliberalism's version of fate. My subject today is the question of how to think ourselves out of market fatalism. Think and act, as Philip Mirowski would very likely add, the problem of metaphors we live by as a metaphor being that it tends to downplay the need to supplement thinking with acting. I want to ask how to make some headway under present conditions against neoliberalism's version of necessity as the market, assuming that this may involve deciding how far the present administration can or cannot be described as neoliberal. According to Nancy Fraser, in a piece that people may have seen, the vote that put Donald Trump in the White House was a vote to end neoliberalism. The title of the piece Fraser published in Dissent in January was more precisely the end of progressive neoliberalism. Progressive neoliberalism, as Fraser defines it, is an alliance of mainstream currents of new social movements, feminism, anti-racism, multiculturalism, LGBTQ rights, on the one side, and high-end symbolic and service-based business sectors, Wall Street, Silicon Valley, and Hollywood, on the other. This is still a quote. In this alliance, progressive forces are effectively joined with the forces of cognitive capitalism, especially financialization. However, unwittingly, the former lend their charisma to the latter. Ideals like diversity and empowerment, which could in principle serve different ends, now gloss policies that have devastated manufacturing and what were once middle-class lives. That's the end of the quote. In other words, progressive neoliberalism means, roughly speaking, the Hillary Clinton coalition, progressive on matters of recognition, but not on matters of redistribution. This is a case for why people, the majority of people, those who suffer most from unequal distribution, are right to hate liberal elites. Liberal elites are those who are liberal on recognition, but not on redistribution. I, too, hate them. I hope this doesn't involve anyone personally present. I'm not sure the defacers of our posters will have understood how many of us hate liberal elites, or how familiar this line of argument is among those they think of as liberal elites. Not just as a case against the Clinton coalition, its mishandling of the presidential campaign fatally determined by its commitment to Wall Street and its non-recognition of the problem of distribution, but as a case against multiculturalism and other isms of our time. I imagine we have all probably encountered some version of the idea that there is a secret complicity between neoliberalism and many of the supposedly progressive positions taken in the academy. For example, the epistemological common sense that boils down to X is a construct. I can think of examples from Terry Eagleton and David Lodge that are now at least 30 years old. More recently, since the publication of Michel Foucault's lectures from the late 70s, it's been argued vigorously about Foucault's characteristic concern with excluded minorities and revolts of conduct. The case is made, for example, in Mitchell Dean and Caspar Villardson's book, State Phobia and Civil Society, The Political Legacy of Michel Foucault, which came out last year from Stanford. Dean and Villardson conclude that when Foucault talks about Gary Becker and American neoliberalism, he should not be seen as critical of them. Defenders of Foucault, like Bernard Harcourt, try to make that case, but cannot find the evidence for it. The truth is that Foucault's approach to the state, they say, was resolutely anti-statist, like that of the neoliberals and that of the Rocardian wing of the French socialists, the PSU, the Unified Socialist Party, which was enthused about so-called self-management, autogestion, and to which Foucault was close in his final years. Perhaps Foucault himself cannot simply be labeled a neoliberal, but the extraordinary success of his set of anti-normative and decentralizing themes, difference, minority, exclusion, and so on, plants those themes firmly in the context of neoliberalism, which they describe, that's still Dean and Villardson, as the most important and virulent anti-statist movement of the last half century. In other words, whether or not it is now at an end, there is such a thing as progressive neoliberalism. In bringing up the term anti-statism, however, I'm also taking some distance from Fraser's argument. Fraser says that the vote for Trump and against Clinton was a vote against progressive neoliberalism. But what is progressive about progressive neoliberalism, even as she herself defines it, clearly depends on state intervention. State intervention on behalf of minorities, as well as state intervention in the economy. The Clinton coalition did, of course, help deregulate financial capital, among its other sins, but it cannot be described as fundamentally anti-statist. If neoliberalism is defined by its anti-statism, the vote for Trump and against Clinton was a vote for neoliberalism, not a vote against it. You could say it was a neoliberal vote. If this sounds too crude, and I'm certainly open to that possibility, it may be because a vote, or you think because a vote, even the quite dramatic vote of November 8th, feels like too crude a measure of where we are in relation to neoliberalism. When Nancy Fraser speaks of the end of progressive neoliberalism, isn't she underestimating neoliberalism's cultural tenacity, the comprehensiveness and ingrainedness that make it the favorite candidate for those who want to name the social totality, that explain why the financial crisis of 2008 did not provoke greater changes, that make neoliberalism seem so much like fate? If neoliberalism is a set of epistemic commitments, as Philip Mirowski's phrase, commitments that go deeper than any mere set of ideas or beliefs and that determine how we evaluate our ideas and beliefs, then perhaps we're obliged to work at a deeper level of analysis, I ask. The problem is, the deeper we go, the farther we get from such actions as voting, the more coherent and socially comprehensive we decide neoliberalism is, the more likely we are to decide also that neoliberalism really is fate. So this is a bit of a dilemma within which I'm trying to work. How coherent and how comprehensive is neoliberalism? My uncertainty about this question is one reason why I chose for my title the emotionally and electorally charged phrase, liberal elites. The phrase operates, I think, quite successfully at the level of voting behavior. Why do so many people hate and vote against liberal elites. Why does the noun elite attract the adjective liberal rather than, say, conservative? It's not just because liberal elites benefit economically from the current system of resource distribution while looking down at those who don't share their pious habits of recognition. On the whole, you will not be targeted as a member of the elite if you are rich, even if you inherited your money. You will be blamed for being an elite if you exercise some degree of power without being rich. If you receive that power instead from your education, your credentials, your place in a bureaucracy. Bureaucracy and professionalism are hated more than wealth. Taking the state broadly and loosely, so that it includes experts and professionals, private universities as well as public ones, private polling agencies like Gallup that somehow compute as officialdom, the use of the phrase liberal elites maps along the lines of anti-statism. So-called elites take their authority from something other than capital, and the easiest, if not the most accurate, synecdoche for that something is the state. I'm willing to grant, as Philip Mirowski argues, that to call neoliberalism anti-statist would be an oversimplification. That in order to create the conditions that would preclude a planned economy and a vibrant welfare state, neoliberalism's champions knew they needed to seize and retask, these are his words, the state, not destroy it. But it seems to me that this seizing and retasking of the state have themselves required anti-statism, at the visceral electoral level represented by the phrase liberal elites, and that doing something about anti-statism is therefore not a misguided use of our energies, as some critics of neoliberalism go so far as to suggest. On the contrary, it ought to be high on the agenda of anyone who wants to undo the grim perception that for us, fate and the competitive market are the same thing. So basically, that's all I wanted to say. And I could therefore stop, but I'm going to use the time that I've got anyway to connect this to cultural materials, which I hope will not seem too out of left field. As some of you will know, the genre of Scandinavian murder mystery, or Nordic noir, has often been read as a critique of the Scandinavian welfare state from the left. It is not always easy to see the difference between critique of the welfare state from the left and neoliberal critique of the welfare state, or critique from the right, a critique which has been gaining ground in Scandinavia as elsewhere in Europe. Some of the problem is a lack of clarity about the place of the state in world history, that world history on which Nordic noir as a rising genre within world literature implicitly depends. So that's what I'm going to talk about for the next few minutes. As the field of world literature has been rising, literary critics like Weitschi Dimmock have aligned its rise with a decentering of the modern nation-state, now seen as a Eurocentric and triumphalist endpoint of modern history. Literature is valued by Dimmock and others for being transnational, and by transnational what they mean is critical of and detached from the modern nation-state. The value of world literature as such gets identified with this refusal of the values of the modern nation state, even when or especially because those values include things like secularism, democracy, and equality. You can see what this looks like as world history by considering the recent book Empires in World History, Power and the Politics of Difference by Jane Burbank and Frederick Cooper. Burbank and Cooper compare the modern nation-state with the pre-modern empire and find the pre-modern empire ethically superior. I quote, "The nation-state tends to homogenize those inside its borders and exclude those who do not belong, while the empire reaches outward and draws, usually coercively, peoples whose difference is made explicit under its rule. The concept of empire presumes that different peoples within the polity will be governed differently." What's distinctive about empire, in other words, is that it accepts diversity as its very substance. Unlike the nation state, then, it finds ways of managing diversity. Burbank and Cooper are trying to get away, as they write, from the usual and, we think, misleading shorthands and signposts, a transition from empire to nation state, a distinction between pre-modern and modern states, a focus on Europe and the West as uniquely powerful agents of change for good and for evil, or for evil. From their perspective, to value the empire as a distinct mode of governance is to avoid Eurocentrism. Unfortunately, it is also to take the focus off violence. Burbank and Cooper are perfectly clear that empires cannot be made or sustained without violence. Empires, they say, hardly represented a spontaneous embrace of diversity. Violence and day-to-day coercion were fundamental to how empires were built and how they operated. But violence and coercion are not their emphasis. The real point is successful management of difference. Keeping to the new enlarged timescale on which studies like this are working, one wonders what they would say about the Vikings, pardon me, I'm thinking Scandinavia, that is, about the days when diversity of population was very real, but it was achieved by stealing women from the farms and villages that were raided from the sea after the menfolk had been slaughtered. In those days, of course, no moral norm existed that would be violated by the raiding of farms and villages from the sea, the killing of the men, the stealing of the women, along with the portable property. Those ethical norms arguably arose in modernity along with the modern nation state. Burbank and Cooper don't appear to concede either the link between modernity and ethical norms that discouraged the massacre of civilians, or that nation states, however much violence they may be guilty of, are not forced to use violence by their very principle of being, as they admit empires are. Within world literature, to take one more example, Susan Stanford Friedman's enthusiasm for the bloody conquests of the Mongols, who, as she sees it, brought with them to the lands they conquered a higher stage of civilization, duplicates point for point the arguments made sometime later in favor of European conquests and European imperialism. Imperialism suddenly seems to be fine, as long as it's not Europeans who are doing it. If such arguments are pursued and accepted, European imperialism itself will turn out to be fine. I think it's time to step back from our supposed critiques of Eurocentrism and consider whether we may have been a bit hasty in throwing overboard the ethical norms that justified anti-imperialism, norms that are historically entangled with the modern nation state. So I'm going to skip some of this. I'm obviously saying that the programmatic anti-statism here offered up as a supposed rebuttal of Eurocentrism results in a serious misinterpretation of various cultural artifacts and practices. And one might argue, if you will forgive a little name-calling, but it's appropriate under the circumstances, that what they are in fact proposing is exactly what Fraser calls progressive neoliberalism. The formula is diversity plus anti-statism. So here I will make another quick turn into even weirder territory. The version of world history that the world literature people are trying to avoid, the triumphalist Whig version, can be represented for my purposes by Steven Pinker's 2011 book, The Better Angels of Our Nature, Why Violence Has Declined. Pinker thinks that the decline of violence is one of the most significant facts about the history of the modern world. Pre-modernity, for Pinker, is extremely violent. His examples begin with miraculously preserved Stone Age corpses, which turn out on inspection to have arrowheads embedded in them. He spends a lot of time on humanistic landmarks like the Bible and Homer. The tales of massacre and rape recounted in Homer, Pinker writes, are disturbing even by the standards of modern war documentaries. But all this terrible human waste was accepted, Pinker says, quote, as an inescapable fact of life, like the weather, something that everyone talked about, but no one could do anything about. Rather than framing the scourge of warfare as a human problem for humans to solve, he comments, the Greeks concocted a fantasy of hot-headed gods and attributed their own tragedies to the gods' jealousies and follies. Much has been said at the expense of Pinker's argument that in the modern era, violence has declined. It's been noted that he neglects the violence of colonialism, which gets no mention in the book's otherwise ample index, that he omits the hyper-religiosity of the United States from his portrait of an increasingly secularized modernity, that he expresses unwarranted confidence in global commerce as an anti-militaristic factor, and that he overestimates the peacefulness of the contemporary world. Each of these criticisms seems to me well-founded. His flip tone is, to say the least, off-putting. But I admit to being intrigued by the idea, it's the central idea for me, that violence used to be like the weather, but no longer is. That the real causes of violence have little by little been understood to be natural, not supernatural. That violence has little by little come under human control, though of course very unequally and incompletely. And that to the extent that these things have happened, humans have been able to give up on traditional versions of fatalism, the belief that violence is both mysterious and unavoidable and must therefore be attributed to the gods or to God or to fate. I'm not sure that the word fate would have caught my eye the way it did, despite my inclination to be more sympathetic than most to Pinker's secularization story. If I had not been reading for other reasons, Robert Pippin's book, Fatalism in American Film Noir. For Pippin, American film noir is fatalist in that it operates within a mode of thinking about violence that, according to Pinker, is characteristically ancient and has now become obsolete. His focus is on agency. Agency for him means, roughly speaking, I know what I'm doing. What I'm doing is subject to deliberative control. I can give reasons for it. And that I have some capacity to direct the course of events accordingly. Pippin describes these three tenets as the Western humanist inheritance. The argument of his book, he says, is that all three of these assumptions have become less and less robustly credible, less widely shared than they once were. And film noir can be considered something like testimony of this shift. According to the noir genre in its American version, in other words, people do not possess either the necessary self-knowledge for this picture of agency to be convincing, or the necessary confidence that their actions will in fact direct the course of events. In other words, confidence that they understand and control even the small corner of the world they inhabit. If Pippin is right, then noir returns us to what antiquity saw as submission to fate. And that is the conclusion he draws, referring to the philosopher Bernard Williams on what fate meant to the Greeks. Bernard Williams was likely right, Pippin concludes, that in important ways we are, in our ethical situation, more like human beings in antiquity than any Western people have been in the meantime. If Pippin is correct, and if American noir is representative, then Steven Pinker's story needs a very radical revision. Whether or not violence has declined, objectively speaking, it remains true that as readers and viewers of noir, we continue to feel that violence is the effect of a random, disordered universe that might as well be ruled by the whims of the Olympian gods. The appropriate motto might be Kurt Vonnegut's reaction to the deaths in Slaughterhouse 5, so it goes. So what does this all have to do with the murder mystery genre in Scandinavia? Taken at its most general, the murder mystery might be described as a genre that, whatever else it does, posits a rational and secular understanding of violence, as well as a certain competence in dealing with it. In that sense, it's part of Pinker's secularization story. Thanks to the murder mystery, violence becomes something that, however incomprehensible in appearance, turns out to be rationally explicable and more or less controllable or manageable. Some would say more manageable, others would say less manageable. If you put back the noir, you might be tempted to decide that Nordic noir is not nearly as noir as American noir, maybe not noir enough to be called noir at all. In the murder mystery, the basic paradigm is of a social order violated by a murder and then restored to its proper legitimacy by the exposure and elimination of the murderer. In Noir, the restoration and the legitimacy are no longer available. The social order we see in Noir does not make sense. The villain cannot be assumed to be violating norms in which we believe. The detective and the resolution of the plot cannot be assumed to uphold those norms. I'm going a little quickly here. One might object then that the Scandinavians remain too confident that if the perpetrator of violence can be exposed and identified, the person will be brought to justice. The Mexican critic Carlos Monsiváis argued some decades ago that detective fiction in Mexico is impossible because everyone knows that the accused would never be punished, not unless he happened to be poor. If the identity of the criminal was established and he was not poor, the only suspense would involve the particular means by which he avoided punishment. We have no crime fiction here, Monsiváis concluded, because there is no faith in justice. Readers of Roberto Bolaño's masterpiece 2666 will perhaps remember as corroborating evidence the section called The Part About the Crimes. Written in something like the bureaucratic voice of the Mexican state, that section begins over and over what ought to be but fails to be a detective story. A woman's body is discovered. The marks of violence on that body are described as clues that will inform the subsequent investigation. But the investigation does not happen. We discover nothing about the murderer. There is no detective story. There is no justice. Then another body is discovered. Again, nothing happens. There is the desire for a detective story. There is no detective story. Then there is another body. Again, there is no detective story. And so on, until many readers are so intensely frustrated and upset that they cannot continue reading. It's against that background, against the possibility that the machinery of justice will not function at all, that I think the genre of the detective story needs to be seen. My point, however, is not, or not merely, that as an artist of high and uncompromising principles, Bolaño deserves more credit than the writers of Nordic noir, writers who entertain us by offering an illusion of justice. Justice, I would say, is not merely an illusion. You are more likely to think of it as an illusion if you have never encountered it as something real and tangible. Nordic noir multiplies encounters with justice as something tangible. As a successful cultural export, it carries with it out into the world a more complex political message than it may seem to have in its countries of origin. One part of that message is, relatively speaking, a faith that a certain degree of justice can indeed be achieved by the collective will of society, a faith that emerges from the historical experience of the Nordic countries and that readers in places like Mexico have reason to take some comfort from, even or especially if their own experience feels very different. From the perspective of world history, in other words, Nordic noir has to be seen as an accomplishment. A secular space wrested away from fate. A space where violence can be understood and to some extent controlled. And that accomplishment cannot be denied on the grounds that the name of this space is the state or social democracy. The genre ought to be understood with reference to the fact that although it has not happened everywhere, it has happened somewhere. An asymmetry that can be extended to world history in general. Let's not insist piously that anything that has happened in Europe, say, must also have happened outside Europe, preferably earlier, and if not, is not worth treating as in any way admirable. If we inhabitants of a neoliberal age are not to remain slaves to our metaphors, if we are not condemned to accept market competition as fate, the best way of demonstrating our relative freedom is by registering the history of collective action by the state. In other words, at the largest scale of collectivity thus far possible. That history is as imperfect as you would expect from the deportations, the surveillance, the drone strikes, and what we're currently accusing the Russians of, interference in the elections of others. which we know our state to be guilty of. But as the neoliberals might say, there's no alternative. Last page, I'm going to say the same thing again, because I think it needs saying again. To escape fatalism about violence, it's not enough to understand violence. You also have to experience some degree of control over violence, understanding plus collective action. What Robert Pippin omits from his account of fatalism in American film noir is the possibility of an effective agent of collective will. In the case of Nordic noir, we don't have to hesitate, in spite of many qualifiers, in identifying that agent of collective will as the social democratic state. Nordic noir testifies to the enormous pressure that neoliberalism is applying to the social field on a global scale, but it also testifies to the fact that neoliberalism has not yet co-opted all agents and institutions, does not saturate or define that field. We might have come to that conclusion on our own. After all, why else would spirited efforts to shrink or eviscerate the state still be underway? But why not accept help, even from Nordic noir, underpinned as it is by the faith that the state, if always an imperfect expression of the collective will, if ever more threatened by the will of the market, has demonstrably served as an agent of the collective will, thereby permitting a genre of stories to thrive. You don't need me to list current reasons for a resurgence of so it goes fatalism. Climate change, say. The rise of nationalism and xenophobia here and abroad, the defacing of posters at the University of Pittsburgh. The word fatalism pops up all the time, you don't have to search for it. All of this should not diminish the respect that is owed to evidence, wherever it can be found, that on occasion the collective will has been more or less democratically decided on and implemented so as not only to understand violence and inequality, but to bring violence and inequality under some degree of control. Underlining that perception is how to make headway under present conditions against neoliberalism's version of necessity as the market. Those of us who are likely to be called liberal elites, even if we think of ourselves as left of liberal elites, or maybe not as elites at all, we'll find that if we can change hearts and minds on the state's insufficient but workable legitimacy, we will also find we've done something to legitimate ourselves. Thank you.